Wouldn't that be nice if we were never confused about anything in life? Like we had all the answers, we're extremely confident, every day, nothing to think about, we just got it all figured out. Wouldn't that be a nice kind of life? Yeah, sure. Maybe God really wants us to live that kind of life. Like, God surely doesn't want us to be confused, at least I don't think he does. So I think God, was loving God, kind God. I do believe he wants us to live confidently. And his word declares that, you know, that we should be confident in all things. And of course, we are confident in all things in Christ Jesus. So this week I was waiting at my gate for my flight. And I'm just sitting there. I got my earbuds in. I'm listening to some music. And, I see this woman come up to the gate. And she's got what looks like her boarding pass. And she's looking at the boarding pass. And then she's looking at the reader screen for the gate. And then all of a sudden, I didn't know her. She didn't speak a word. But what I did notice was the look on her face, which was confusion. Because she's looking at the ticket, she's looking at the thing. You know, and it's funny, you know, it's like you don't even believe, you don't believe one of the two, or maybe neither, because she kept going back and forth like it was going to change. But I could see the confused look on her face. Now, unfortunately, she was like 2 minutes late because the Chicago flight was going to leave from that gate. They moved it to a different gate. They put the Tampa flight at that gate. So I know more than likely she was heading to Chicago, but the sign said Tampa, and I'm sure her ticket said Chicago. So I said, ma'am, they moved the Chicago gate to C-19. She's like, oh my goodness, thank you, and then took off. And I think that's what happens sometimes in life, right? The confusion usually sets in because there's conflicting data points, right? I have a data point, but then I have maybe a thought or an idea. And maybe it's not congruent. It's not the same as. It's not exact. And so, confusion, right? That's usually where confusion comes in. I have two different sets of data points. And I don't think God wants us to be confused. Again, when we think about it, you know, in the terms of spiritual context, I believe God is very clear. And I believe the more we understand God, the more we understand who we are, and the more we understand what our purpose is, we really won't be confused, because I think a lot of times, for me anyway, I forget who I am, or I forget my purpose in life, and then confusion sets in. I'm like the lady standing there. It's like, which way? Well, who are you? I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ lives in me, and I live by the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself to me. But even that scripture, church, I can tell you, I mean, I've quoted it for a lot of years, but I still have a hard time believing or understanding I was crucified with Christ on that cross. Why do I have a hard time thinking about that or believing that? Well, because I wasn't there 2,000 years ago, that's why. But you see, there's the confusion, because that data point has got to be right. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
So if I think other than that, then now I'm taking the arrow and I'm going this way. And God's like, no, you were crucified. That way of thinking, that lifestyle, that was crucified. He died the death for us all. He died the death for all. I mean, our Bible also says that. So when I think of something other than that, that's really not who I am. Because that person, that nature, that being really was crucified. The only thing that truly is alive, who I am, who you are, is Christ. And then I live my life by, like he says in the verse, faith. Amen. Now, faith may not line up with how I think sometimes, or see, or feel, or whatever. And so I stand there, and I'm looking at the Bible, I'm looking at my circumstances, and then you guys see the confused look on my face, right? It's like, but I don't think God wants us to live like that. Because then I can't be confident. And he even says that in Philippians, that you should be confident of this very thing, that he which begun a good work in you will complete it in the day of Christ Jesus. Who completes us? God. I can't complete myself. You can't complete yourself. God will complete you. But what do you got to do? He says you got to be confident. He knows what he's doing. He's going to complete you. In what? The day of Christ Jesus. What day is that? The day you realize that Christ dwells inside of you and that's who you are. And any other notion otherwise is not true. It's just not true. So that's why this is where we got to start here, right? That's the foundation. That's the basis of all things. And then when I understand that God is not looking to confuse us in this life, but truly give us hope, purpose, direction, and know who we are. You are the Son of God, the daughter of God, the Christ that dwells inside of you. And so anytime we find ourselves in the course of a week thinking otherwise, it's just not so, church. It's just not true. And then confusion does come along. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. What has changed about Christ? Nothing. He's very consistent, church, let me tell you. He is so consistent. How consistent is he? Man, he's going to love you and forgive you every day for the rest of your life. There's no decision point there. That decision was already made. It's final. He is the same. So anytime we're not the same, we're not consistent, confusion. And I believe this is the life he's called us to, that we will be the same as Christ Jesus, the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. We just live as Christ. Amen? So I saw this verse in Psalms. In thee, O Lord, do I put my trust. Let me never be put to confusion. And of course, this is David's prayer to God. He says, Lord, and why? I believe he was just having a little bit of identity crisis, church. Anybody ever have those? Not on Sundays, Pastor, but Monday when I'm sipping my coffee. No, just me. Yeah, that's what David, but he's saying, hey, but I know who I am. I know God's real. I know he's alive. Never let me be put to confusion. I pray that's our prayer. I pray that's my prayer. Lord, never let me be put to confusion. Let me never forget who I am and what my purpose is in this life. There won't be any confusion. There can't be any confusion, amen? So confusion is really, it's just a lack of trust in God. That's where my confusion comes in, because I don't, again, it's like the Bible says, well, am I really crucified with Christ? Yeah, Phil, you are, man. You just got to trust me. And I'm doing a work in you. I'm doing a work in everybody out here. You just got to trust me in that. I know what I'm doing. And the more I trust God, I believe, church, the less confusion I have in my life. Like, how could you not? I mean, if you're trusting God, and it's not to say, I believe you do trust God. You're here this morning, amen? You trust him to come to church and worship him and love him. And when we trust him, there is a confidence. There is a boldness. There's an awareness that he's real and he's alive and life has matter to it. It has purpose to it. Amen? But the minute I start to question that or question what God is doing in my life, because I'm looking at my boarding ticket, but then I'm looking at the circumstances, and that confused look comes on my face. He's like, son, look at the real boarding pass here now. It's going to get you where you need to go, I promise. You're at the right gate. You just got to trust him. And the more we trust him, church, the less confusion we will have in our life. And why is that? For God is not the author of confusion, but of peace. In how many churches of the saints? All churches? All the churches in Lehi? Fort Myers? The world? Wow, that's a big God. That's somebody that we probably should put our trust in then, amen? Like he's in control of all of the churches in the world? Yes, yes. And what's his purpose? It's peace, church. It's peace. And really, do you have peace when you're confused, by the way? Like, I'm sure that lady, if I would have said, hey, you look very peaceful right now. You look peaceful right now. You can't be peaceful if you're confused. You can't. That's why he says that. I'm not the author of that. I'm not the author of that. I'm looking for peace in how many churches? All the churches, all the saints. It's peace. It's peace. He doesn't author the confusion, church. God's not confused. He expects peace in all the churches. I believe this is the gospel. This is the good news that we preach, that it is to mankind. And I don't know what they're preaching up the block. I don't know what they're preaching in Tampa today. I don't know what they're preaching in China today. I don't know. But I know God is not the author of confusion. And it's still peace for all, no matter what, no matter where they're at, no matter what gate they're getting on and where they're going, church. So who is the author of confusion? For where envying and strife is, there is confusion and every evil work that comes out of the earth is birthed out of confusion, according to James. And what is the envying and the strife? When you look at the original Greek words there, that word envying, it means that I'm looking to defend my position. I'm looking to defend myself. And isn't that some truth now? When you look to defend, I don't know, maybe I want to defend New Image Ministries. But it's at the expense of some other church that's envying church. I say, you gotta come here, you can't go there. That's envying church. That's an evil work. It brings confusion, as though God doesn't want peace down there. He just wants peace here. You understand what I'm saying? And then that word strife, it means to fracture something, to break something. What am I breaking? Relationships, church. I'd rather break the relationship over whatever it is, whatever the circumstance. Maybe it has to do with God. Maybe it has nothing to do with God. Maybe it's just life at work somewhere, and I want the cubicle here by the window, and Joey wants it, and so we argue over who's getting the cubicle by the window. Confusion has now just set in. That's an evil work. We are the author of the confusion. Why? Because we take positions and we hold ourselves, and we'd rather fracture the relationship but stay true to ourselves, right? We got to stay true to ourselves. No, you ain't staying true to yourself, church. That's the problem. Christ is inside of you. That's who you truly are. I'd rather keep the relationship and say, Joey, have the cubicle next to the window. I'm cool with that. We cool? Yeah, we're cool, man. Beautiful. That's not an evil work. That's peace. There's nothing fractured about that. But the minute I fracture my relationship because of whatever reason, we always think we have a good reason to fracture it, right? Like, let's break this. No, you're confused. You're confused about who you are, man. You're confused about the Christ that's inside of you and what he's called you to do and his purpose for your life, amen? That's the confusion. I pray there's no confusion. It's just Christ and Christ alone. So we're going to be in Micah today. Micah is one of the minor prophets. I believe he was... Most of his earlier chapters are dealing with the judgment. And again, there's good judgment and there's bad judgment. But again, even the bad judgment, it's only because God, those judgments, he's getting rid of stuff that don't belong because it causes confusion. It's not like he's judging you and hurting you. He's those judgments, when you see the good and the bad judgments, it's to remove the things that hurt us. He doesn't take it away because he thinks it's good for you. He's going to remove it. But Micah's talking about here is judgment the same as Isaiah does. They are actually counterparts in talking about the judgments on the church. But so it starts out here. It says, "Hear all ye," in verse 2, "Hear ye all ye people, hearken, O earth, and all that is therein. Let the Lord God be witness against you, for the Lord from his holy temple." He's talking to everybody, because my Bible says the earth and all that are therein. He was talking to the church, which is Judah, which is Israel, but he was also talking to everybody else. So you skip down to verse 5 here, and it says, "For the transgression of Jacob is all this, for the sins of the house of Israel. What is the transgression of Jacob? Is it not Samaria? And what are the high places of Judah? Are they not Jerusalem?" And so he's talking about, you got the 10 tribes in the north, right? Because there was division in the 12 tribes, right? After Solomon, the two kings said, "Hey, you go do your thing. I'm going to go do my thing. But you know what? We're really not together on this." Confusion. Confusion set into the 12 tribes. Imagine that. So Rehoboam goes north, Jeroboam goes south, and you got 10 in the north and 2 in the south, which is Judah and Benjamin, and that's what they're talking about here. But what is he saying here? He's talking about Samaria. Samaria, listen, because the 10 went north, they were too far from Jerusalem. So what they did, they said, well, we'll make Samaria our city, and you know what, that's where they set up their little temple. And they made their little church, and they made their little congregation, and they made their little denomination. And we'll follow and do this. And it wasn't exactly the same as the folks in the south now, was it? It's never the same in the south, right? South. But the church in the south, which was Jerusalem, Benjamin and Judah, they went to church in Jerusalem. So he's talking about church. He's talking about what they believed, and they strayed, folks, because they took in some folks that weren't from the tribes, and, oh, that sounds good. I'll take a little bit from column A and a little bit from column B, and we'll put them together. Confusion. You see, because I took a little bit from column A, and then I took a little bit from column B. You see where we're going, church? And then I'm at the wrong gate. You see, and that's what happens with Samaria, and that's what happens with Jerusalem. They adopted these things and these beliefs. God was in there. I mean, they loved God. Don't get me wrong. But then they added this stuff, and God's like, oh, my goodness, you're making a mess here. You're confused. You're confused because, again, what did God want? Well, God's looking for the 12 tribes to get back together. He's looking for the band to get back together again. Can I get an amen? Amen. He doesn't want the band split up. Hey, what's the band together, man? You can't make beautiful music if you got a drummer over here and a guitar player over there. Trick, can I get an amen? You need the whole band together, man. But because we've got these ideas of church and religion and we're separate, and it causes the issues, church. James, those who consider themselves religious and yet do not keep a tight rein on their tongues, they deceive themselves, and their religion is worthless. This is James, and I love the rendering here. It's in the NIV. But that's so true, because we don't harness our tongue. We'd rather talk bad about the tribes in the north, because surely those 10 got it wrong. The 2 in the south, man, we got it right. You see, my religion is now worthless. I got nothing good to say. But if I could harness my tongue and say, maybe the Christ that's in them is the same as the Christ in me, and oh my goodness, the purpose is actually for us to be united and to be as one. And this is really, you know, where I need to be looking and understanding, and then my religion will not be worthless. And that's where you know, Judah and Israel or Ephraim are at this point. Go down to verse 6, and it says, therefore I will make Samaria as a heap of a field, and as the planting of vineyards, and I will pour down the stones thereof into the valley, and I will discover the foundations of the world. So what is God saying here? This is God's judgment on Samaria and on Jerusalem. He's taking it down, church. Now, he doesn't take down the people. Can I get an amen? What he's taking down are these ideas and these thoughts that caused the confusion in the first place. Because really, the only way, I got to get rid of the confusion if we're gonna get it right. And what does he take it down to? Well, my Bible says, what do you know? I found the foundation. Once I clear out all the rubble, once I take everything out, all these things that you built and added on top of it, now once I clear it all and I send all this down, I'm actually going to plant a vineyard. Can you imagine that? I'm going to put something new in there, something that's spiritual, something that really knows and tells me who I am in Christ Jesus. And I find the foundation. What is the foundation, church? For other foundation no man can lay that is laid, which is Christ Jesus. There you go. What's the foundation? What did he discover? Christ. You see, but Christ is there. Christ was always there. Christ was there before they split. Christ was there after they split. Christ was there the whole time they were building their silly ideas and thoughts about life. Same for me. And then God comes along and sends his judgment to do what? Listen, I got to get rid of this mess, because you just built yourself a, it's like the houses where the nursery rhymes are huffing a puffing to blow your house down. That's what God's doing. He's huffing and puffing, he's blowing your house down. And so the only thing that is left is Christ. That's the foundation that you build on. And then what is it? It's based on spirit. It's based on faith. He's not going to blow that down. But anything other than that, he's going to blow it down. He just takes it down. Get rid of this. Get rid of this rubble. It's worthless. Your religion, it's worthless. It's no good. It fractures. It causes confusion. It causes division. And God's like, man, that's a mess, man. I'm just going to get rid of this. And because he loves us, he gets rid of it. This is a good judgment. Now, again, we see it sometimes as a bad judgment because he's bringing this destruction. And he's bringing everything down. It's always a good judgment. He's just getting rid of this stuff to get to the foundation. Let's get to the root of the matter. What is the root of the matter? It's Christ. It's Christ. When I get to that root, when I know that my foundation, it is in Christ Jesus and yours is in Christ Jesus, and nothing can deter me from that, nothing can move me from that position, then I know and I can live confidently and know that the work that he's doing in me, he's doing in you. And I'm not going to argue over this cubicle over, because I just know that God's working in my life and working in your life, and I'm going to say, hey, okay, I got an awareness here, fine, take the cubicle. Because I'd rather keep the relationship than sever the relationship. You see, and that's really what God's trying. He's teaching them how to live and love one another in the process. You think that's what he's doing with us? Yeah, church. Yeah, it's about a life lived, amen? And that's all that he's doing here. He's just removing these things that don't belong, that caused the confusion in the first place. And here you go. In what verse is this? Sorry, I can't read with the... Let me go down here. I'm reading my Bible. Verse 7, and all the graven images there shall be beaten to pieces, and all the hires thereof shall be burned with the fire, and all the idols thereof will I lay desolate. For she gathered it for hire of a harlot, and they shall return to the hire of a harlot. And again, this is, again, all the things that they were doing. And I love the colorful illustration, which we talked about the harlot before. You know, Revelation talks about the harlot. It's just, listen, it's just the soul of man that thinks they know church, but they don't really know church because their religion is worthless. But what is he doing? Again, he's just getting rid of all that. He's laying it desolate. He's removing it. Is what Psalm says. Have all the workers of iniquity no knowledge, who eat up my people as bread, and they call not upon the Lord? It's just that. Again, we're working for our salvation, church, and then I require you to work for it. That's a worker of iniquity. You can't work for salvation. You can't work for God. You can't work for grace. You can't work for faith. Be confident that he who begun a good work in you will complete it. Who's going to complete it? God. You can't complete the work, church. You can't, according to Scripture. Let's all look at our boarding pass. We got a one-way ticket to heaven, everybody. Amen. Everybody's got one. We're all getting on board. But when I lose sight of that, I think I have to work for a church. And sometimes I do. I get confused. During the course of the week, I've got to do this. Now, it doesn't mean that I want to live my life as Christ and love and be kind. Of course, I want to do all of those things. But I'm not looking to accomplish something, and I don't look for you to accomplish something. I say it's still peace in all the churches. I'm not looking for them to accomplish anything. Just peace in all the churches, man. I love you. I love you just the same. And I pray you love me just the same. But the worker of iniquity, I make you work. I make you work for my love. You know I'm going to make you work for the forgiveness, Ken. Because you're going to have to work for that. You're a worker of iniquity. If we got to work for love, if we got to work for forgiveness, if we got to work for mercy, you haven't found your foundation yet, church. You don't really know who you are. And I'm going to tell you right now, you don't know what your purpose is in this life. You can't. Again, according to the word of God. These are the workers of me. But God just says, hey, let me get rid of all this. That's not who you are, and that's not how you're going to live. You don't have to work for anything. You just got to trust and believe in an almighty God. Amen. Come on, man. Shall the clay say to the potter, why did you make me? Huh? What, like you don't know what you're doing? Church, come on now. Come on, man. Potter knows what he's doing, man. Let the potter do his thing in my life and in your life. Okay? I don't have to work to fix my clay. We all want to work. The clay's going to get broke anyway. Read Jeremiah. Why do we try and fix the clay? It's going to get broken anyway. But we want to try and, you know, buff out some spots, right? Al, we were talking about the cars yesterday. You want to buff it. You know, I got a little dent here. You're going to get dinged up, church. This just in, the clay's getting dinged up. But eventually he's going to crush it anyway. Why? Because the treasure dwells inside the earthen vessel. I'm just trying to get to the treasure, church. Amen. Verse 9, for her wound is incurable. For it has come unto Judah. He has come unto the gate of my people, even unto Jerusalem. What wound is incurable, church? Because I thought God could heal everything. So what is incurable? Hosea says this, when Ephraim saw his sickness and Judah his sores, then Ephraim turned to Assyria and sent to the great king for help. But he is not able to cure you, and he is not able to heal your sores. Ephraim, we're talking about essentially just living this dual life. Sometimes I live here, church, and then sometimes I look at the reader board. Let me see. What's the reader board got to say? Well, Joey wasn't nice to me today, so I'm going to see how I can get him back. And let me see. Well, you know what? I really did want that window seat. Maybe if I get here early enough and just move his stuff. Well, I might wreck the relationship in the process, but I will get my window seat now, won't I? I live in this state of duality. Because some days I say, man, I love God, and I know he loves me, and I know he's called me for a purpose. And then some days I just look at all the circumstances or all these feelings and these emotions that well up inside of me, and I lose sight of my boarding pass, and I say, well, I'm going after this one. And instead of going right, I go left. And that's what's incurable. If you live in both states, you're going to be confused. The only way to cure confusion is you got to quit living like that. You got to quit thinking like that and realizing who you are in Christ Jesus. The cure is Christ. It's the cure for everything, church. And it's only through Christ and Christ alone. But that's what's incurable. We live in both states. We realize there's God, and then we think there's something else. So then Micah goes on, and he talks about and warns about the 11 foreign cities. And he says, declare not in Gath. Like, don't go talk to the people in Gath, and don't go here, and don't go there. And what is he trying to keep us out of? Well, 11 is just 11 is that it's the number of confusion, keeping you out of just that. He wants to keep you from the state of confusion. And so God is saying, listen, I am working in you. I know you want help, but he says right there, he told you not to go to the king. Who is the king? He's talking about the Assyrian king. We go to the flesh for the help. Sometimes it's myself, because sometimes I say, well, God, you know, I love the dish you made out of me, and it's a beautiful dish, but it's just not quite the way I like it. And I tell the potter that I'm going to fix the clay myself. There's no cure for that. You just got to let God be God and let him complete you. No matter what you try and do, you can't. But that's a state of confusion. And really, who was the author of confusion? Because my Bible says, when you go back into Genesis, remember there was confusion upon all of the earth because they all spoke one language. And it said that their face was upon the earth. The identity was in the earth. It was natural. It wasn't spiritual. It wasn't Christ. It was Nimrod. Remember Nimrod, and they built the Tower of Babel? They loved God. They wanted to talk to God. They wanted to see God. They want to experience God. I'm like, who doesn't want to do that, church? Everybody, I pray on Sunday this morning, wants to do that. And so they built their towers out of brick. Again, it's man's ideas. It's man's way. And that's why we're making it out of brick. It's not God's. It's not on this foundation. But therein came the confusion, because as soon as they got to the tower built, what happened? It said they all spoke a different language, and no one could talk to nobody, and there was nothing but confusion in the land. And Nimrod was the son of Cush, who was the son of Ham. Who was Ham? He was one of Noah's three sons. It's always in the family, church, by the way. It's not out there. It's in the family. It's always the family, church. It was one of Noah's sons, remember? And Noah got drunk, and Ham walked in on his pops, and he was naked and drunk, and then he came back, and he told his two brothers, like, Dad's in there, he got drunk, he's naked, he's all messed up, man. Now, Ham loved God. I mean, he grew up in Noah's house. He had to know God and love God. But where was the honor in that? My Bible says, honor your father and your mother, that your days will be long upon the earth. Ham and his children were cursed. Because right away, we think we got to call it out. Like, it's our job to, you know, to tell everybody what went wrong, what happened. And that's just not true. And I love that the Bible says, honor your mother and your father. It doesn't say to love them. Isn't that funny? Maybe because he knows there's going to be some times where, you know what? When Dad tells you, get ready, you're going to church. You're going to church 365. You might not love him, church. You might be mad. Imagine that. What should my dad do? Give up on God? What should he lose sight of his boarding pass? No, he shouldn't lose sight of his boarding pass. And he's going to tell his boys to get ready and go to church. But what do? You honor them just the same. You honor them. You do honor them. And I believe you do love them, don't get me wrong. But there are days where, yeah, because of that, because someone will hold on to a standard and say, no, this is the way and there is no other way to live life, it's going to cause some friction. And I imagine that's what happened with Noah and his three boys. And Ham just said, whatever. But he was cursed and so was his son. So Nimrod was the son, the grandson of Ham. And then, of course, the 11 cities that we're talking about, Cush also gave birth to Canaan, which you get the land of Canaan. The land of Canaan was in the family, church. But Canaan gave birth to 11 sons. You know who he gave birth to? All the ites that were in the lands. The Hevites, the Hittites, the Jebusites. There was 11 of them. It's the state of confusion. Because and Cush actually means black. It's just ignorant. And Nimrod means pride. I'm just prideful. I'm ignorant. I'm prideful. And that's what ignorance will do that too. You think you know, and you don't know, and it'll just give birth to pride. And then I do and say silly things, but it causes just this state of confusion. So Micah's saying, hey, listen, you gotta stay out of these cities. You gotta stay out of this confusion. So what are some of these cities? We can't go through all 11 of them, but let's go through some of them that I found funny. The city of Sapphire. But I'm looking down on you in a supportive kind of way. We think less of others. It's really that simple, church. When you think less of others, you're confused. You have forgotten your foundation, and you have forgotten the foundation in the one that you are thinking less of. Those are the ones that are dwelling. Those are the people that are in Sapphire. You got to stay out of Sapphire, because if you don't, by the way, he does destroy the 11 cities too. Like, he's going to fix the church. It's not like, you know, whoever and whatever the circumstances are, like God says, they can just go ahead and be a wreck too. No, he brings judgment on them too and fixes them too. He don't let them just run amok and do it. No. He actually destroys these 11 cities. Again, he's going to get rid of the confusion, church. Whether it's in my life, their life, whose ever life. Like, God's still a loving God. Whatever they declare and believe, God's love is not based on that. That's the whole point of loving and trusting in God. Like, we try to manipulate one another. You can't manipulate God. He's not looking to be manipulated either. I just love you. It's free.
But when we don't believe something is free, that's why I try and work for it. You follow what I'm saying, church? And sometimes I'm like, man, can you be that big and that loving and that kind? And woo, sometimes it is hard to comprehend. Amen. Sometimes it just is. And sometimes you just got to say, man, God, whoo. You ever give God the woo? Yeah, I mean, I think we do it a lot of times. That he's that kind and that loving and that understanding. But we think less of others. And sometimes we think it's our moral obligation. No, just the pastor. You've lost sight of who you are. You've lost sight of your, where is that? I think it's in Luke. Forgive me. Luke, it's not in the slide there. I believe it's the words of Christ. Luke chapter 11, verse 20. Notwithstanding, in this rejoice not, that the spirits are subject unto you, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven. Jesus Christ says your name is written in heaven. He says, don't rejoice because, hey, you got control of this thing. Don't rejoice because, you know, you got the spirit subject under you and you're not doing whatever you think everybody else is doing. Don't rejoice over that. Who cares? You don't look to accomplish it. And you can accomplish it. Here's what you rejoice over, church. Your name is written in heaven. He's got a registry up there, and he says, yep, Ken, Phil, Janice, Bill. God's writing our name in heaven. Never mind Hollywood. You know, the Walk of Stars or whatever? You know, they make a big deal. You got your star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. No, there's... Your name, you do have your name on a star. It's written in heaven, church. Why? Because Jesus Christ said so. Now, again, that may be hard to comprehend this morning. There's a star with my name written on it in heaven. God knows my name, and he wrote it on a star, and it's in heaven. Sometimes that's hard to comprehend. I get that. But you do got to land there and believe and trust God that that is true. And don't think less of others. If you got control of this, the spirits he's talking about, because in the previous verse he's talking about the demons and all these things. Yeah, it's my mouth. It's my condemning thoughts and my judgmental ways and my, hey, look at him, he got drunk and he's naked. Zip it. My name's written on the stars. By the way, when they found the lady caught in adultery and they dragged her, and remember Jesus, I believe that's what he wrote. He wrote their names in the dirt. Because they would have known that. The scribes and Pharisees had to memorize the first five books of the Bible. Can you imagine having to memorize? Church, I can't do that. At least I don't think I can. I haven't really, I guess maybe if I give it some try. But they had to memorize. So they would have known, because in Deuteronomy it says that your name will be blotted in the earth. He's going to blot that out. Why? Well, because he wrote it in heaven, church. That's what Jesus Christ just said. But when you live that life, when you live a natural life and you condemn and you want to throw rocks, when I look to take the cubicle by the window, I got to write fill in the dirt. When I look to fracture my relationship because, you know, I don't like what you said, excuse me a second, I'm going to write my name in the dirt. And I forgot that he wrote my name on a star in heaven. Like, how could we lose sight of that? We get confused. So we got to stay out of the city of Sapphira. He don't want us in there. And then Zanin, it says that when the winds of change come along, you want to build up walls. You could build a windmill. You could have a much better life. And who's in Zanin? We just refuse to change. God comes along and says, hey, it's time to change, and the winds of change are coming in. Sometimes we know when the winds of change are coming in. What do? Can we fight the wind? You're not going to change me. You're not going to blow me over. Listen, he'll make that wind as big and as bad as he's got to. He's going to blow the house down, like I said. But it's only because he knows, church. He knows what's laid and what's been built up is no good, and it's going to hurt me in the long run. So that's why he's got to take it down. And we put up these walls. We think we're protecting ourselves. You're not protecting anything, church. You're really not. And the walls are going to come down, right? You read the story of Jericho? The walls do come down. And it's just, again, it's a foolish thinking. Nabal, remember the story of Nabal when David looked for him for help? He said, I ain't going to help you. His wife said, no, you got to really help him. He's a king. He's a good guy. He's trying to help us. No, I'm not going to help him. It says that he went in and drank his wine, just like Noah, imagine. Whatever intoxicates you in life, church, it'll pull you away from your boarding pass. Put the cup down. Put it down. It's okay. Sometimes I got to put my cup down. We all got a cup. I don't know what's in the cup, but just put it down, would you? Because we get intoxicated. But it says that night he died and his heart turned to stone. And then 10 days later, the Lord smote him. So you're still alive. What happened? Your heart, it's a stubborn heart. You don't change. You're not compassionate. He wouldn't help David. His wife's like, come on, why can't you just help him? Nope. And it's just stubbornness. It's just silly stubbornness. And you're no good to God. Like, God can't use you. If you're not going to change, how can he use you? You can't use you. You got to stay out of Zanon. The city of Bethzel. But surely you agree that the truth can be created by the repetition of a lie. It's like that Seinfeld episode where Jerry's got to beat the lie detector test. And he says, well, I have access to one of the dubious minds, George. He's like, you're living a lie. He's like, living a lie? I live 10 lies. I'm always living a lie. He's like, well, how can I beat this thing? He says, Jerry, it's not a lie if you believe it. You can believe the lie all you want. It still ain't going to make it truth. And these are the people in Beth Azel. It's perceived truth. It's what Jesus told the scribes and the Pharisees, the guys that knew the first five books of the Bible, memorized it. We get so focused on memorizing it and like, again, that's the work. That's the work of the iniquity now. I mean, get away from me. I don't have time to talk to you right now. Why? Well, I'm trying to memorize Proverbs right now. No, it's the relationship. Put the Bible down. God knows. Come on. God knows. Besides, the word's written on your heart. Isn't that what the Bible says? Oh, okay. So maybe the words that he really is after is the words you're going to speak to the person that wants to just have a cup of coffee with you. But the scribes and the Pharisees, he said, listen, you scribes, you Pharisees, you hypocrites. You pay a tithe on the mint and the anise and the cumin. And you omit the weightier things of the law, mercy and faith. Do these. Leave the other undone. Like, they were tithing on the small. It'd be like, you know, someone giving you a salt shaker. And you say, I got a tithe on this salt shaker. And what do? You take some of the grains of salt on it and you put it in. Like, you're going to worry about the little finest details of the first five books of the Bible. But mercy comes along, or faith comes along, and you say, no, but I got to get to this little thing. You have omitted the weightier matters of the law. Mercy. I do love that he says mercy first. He's a God of order, right? So it's always mercy, church. It's always mercy. Well, we got perceived truth. Listen, there's truth. There's